Hello, so nice to meet you at this daily motivational meeting, reading quotes from world scriptures. These quotes empower billions of people and will help you too. We're reading the book from the beginning. Please find all the chapters at our Message to Billions channel. And today's special, we have very interesting quote about eternal life. For many, the goal of religion is immortality of eternal life. People have always suffered under the limitations of mortality and have found in religion the means to transcend the death which seems to proscribe the possibilities of human existence. As with the resurrection, eternal life is not simply about the survival of the soul at death and its journey into the afterlife. Eternal life is not about eternal existence per se, but rather about the quality of that existence. We find that the scripture of many religions give two meanings to the terms life and death. There is physical life existence on this earth plane, and there is spiritual life, the state of blessedness which endures from life to life and transcends death. There is physical death, the dropping of the body, which is an even in the voyage of every soul, and spiritual death, the condition of distance from God, ignorance, and the hellish existence in hereafter. Eternal life and immortality, they are thus cheap hairs to describe the conditions of blessedness. This condition is present already in the physical life of a person who realizes truth of or lives in God's grace. And it will continue unabated in the hereafter. The person who gains eternal life has accomplished the goal of life, and hence death is not to be feared as a limitation, as it is for a worldly person who has tied all hopes to his possessions and pleasure in this world. We note, however, that Buddhist scriptures generally avoid speaking of this state of blessedness as eternal life. For Buddhism views the desire for life as a kind of grasping and hence a fetter to liberation. Instead, they speak of nirvana. Father Moon teaches that the eternal life is rooted in our relationship with the eternal God, based upon God's love for us and our love for God. Eternity does not exist apart from true love, he states. Then he expands upon this concept to describe the relationship between human lovers as aspiring for the eternal. This is so because we human beings are designed for eternal life, eternal love with God, and eternal community with the ones we love under God. Eternal life and God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And those who have faith and go righteous deeds, they are the best of creatures. Their reward is with God, and gardens of eternity beneath which rivers flow. They will dwell there forever. God will please with them and they with him. All this for such as fear their Lord and cherish it. The Supreme Being does not die. I will therefore not die. Being in accord with Tao, he is everlasting. Where one sees nothing but the one, hears nothing but the one, knows nothing but the one, there is the infinite. Where one sees another, hears another, knows another, there is the finite. The infinite is immortal, the finite is mortal. It is written, he who has realized the eternal truth does not see death, no illness, no pain. He sees everything as the self and obtains all. Those who are free from desire are free because all these desires have found fulfillment in their self. They do not die like the others, but realizing Brahman, they merge in Brahman. So it is said, when all the desires that surge in the heart are renounced, the mortal became immortal. When all the knots that estrange the heart are loosened, the mortal became immortal. Here is this very life. For the wage of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. From the unreal, lead me to the real. From darkness, lead me to light. From death, lead me to immortality. Here, then, this is Brahman, the supreme, the great, hidden in all things, body by body. The one immerses of the universe. By knowing him as Lord, man became immortal. I know this mighty person of the color of the sun beyond darkness. So only by knowing him does not pass over death. There is no one, no other path for going there, that whom there is nothing else higher, that whom there is nothing smaller, nothing greater. The one stands like a tree established in heaven. By him, the person, this whole world is filled. That which is beyond this world is without form and without all. There they who know that became immortal, but others go only to sorrow. The supreme stage of the soul is free from birth, old age, and death. He is supreme, pure, and devoid of either eight karmas. He possesses infinite knowledge, intuition, bliss, and potency. He is invisible, indestructible, and inexhaustible. Besides, he is super sentient and unparalleled, is free from obstruction, merit, demerit, and rebirth, and is eternal, steady, and independent. For the living know that they shall die. These are the righteous who in their death are called living, but the dead know nothing. These are the wicked who in their lifetime are called dead. Leave the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Father, let's read quotes from the Second Coming Messiah, Father Simon Moon, when a follower asked Jesus if he could go home to bury his descendant father. Jesus said, leave the dead to bury their own dead. From these words of Jesus, it is clear that the Bible contains two different concepts of life and death. The first concept of life and death concept, physical life, hence death means the end of physical life. As was the case of the disciples and deceased father who was to be buried. Life in that sense means that state in which the physical self maintains its physiological functions. The second concept of life and death concept concerns those living who had gathered to bury the deceased man, those whom Jesus called the dead. Why did Jesus refer to people whose bodies were alive and active as the dead. He means that since they had not accepted Jesus, they were far removed from the love of God and were dwelling in the realm of Satan's dominion. This second concept of death does not refer to the expiration of physical life. It means leaving the bosom of God's love and falling under the dominion of Satan. The corresponding concept of life refers to the state of living in accordance with God, God's will within the dominion of God's infinite love. Therefore, even if a person's physical self is alive, if he dwells apart from God's dominion and is in servitude to Satan, he is dead, as judged by the original standard of value. A similar conclusion can be drawn from the Lord's words of judgment upon the faithless people of the church in Sardis. You have the name of being alive, and you are dead. On the other hand, even though a person's physical life may be expired, he remains alive in the true sense is if his spirit abides in the kingdom of heaven, in heaven, a realm and spirit world where God governs through love. When Jesus said, "He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall live," he means that those who believe in him and they live with the realm of God's dominion have life. Even after their physical bodies have returned to the soil, their spiritual enjoy life in God's dominion. Jesus also said, "Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." In saying that the believers will never die, I mean that those who believe in Jesus during their earthly life will obtain eternal life, not in this world, but in spirit, which the bosom of God's love. They will be alive both in this life and the next. Jesus' words assure that the death in the sense of end of physical life has no effect on our eternal life. Eternal life does not mean that we merely exist forever in the spirit world. It means we eternally live. How do we cultivate such a life? As human beings, each of us was created to be an object of God's love, God's beloved partner. God cherished true love more than himself. Hence, although God is the center of absolute and eternal life, his ideal of true love is even more absolute and eternal. It is the very core of God. We are the object partners of that true love. How do we come to be in such a precious eternal position? Love is the attribute that brings subject and object into oneness. Love unites a family, it unites the nations in the unity of love. We can participate in anything our beloved does, follow him where he goes, and inherit everything he or she possesses. In the same way, we can inherit God's eternal life. We can inherit God's heart, his heart of love, by which he longed to dwell within each of us and also in the creation. How precious it is to find such a great value within ourselves. What joy, what amazing grace, what an unparalleled blessing. How now we can dwell in the same position as God. Now we can participate in God's eternal love. Originally, human beings are born from true love, grow in true love, live in true love, and die in true love. Where we are not meant to just disappear into a void, since God, the subject of all created beings, is eternal, unchanging, and unique. We who are his partners of love should live eternally. This is the standing point of the logic of eternal life. Life does not begin from life. Life originates from true love, nor the other way around. If God creates something he regards as most precious, would he discard 10 years or 100 years later, or who would he want to keep it for eternity? Obviously, he would create it to last forever. Thus, it is with human beings. Would God created human beings to be born and die, and they are dead in the end? No, he created human beings to live forever. Why? They are the object partners of the absolute God with whom he can share joy and absolute true love. Suppose you were fleeing to a refugee camp. If you had a precious possession, would you take it with you or leave it behind? You would want to take it with you. Once in camps, you will treasure it. You would not enjoy it for a few days and then throw it away. You would keep it until you die and then bequeath it to your descendants for eternity. That is human desire. It is the same with God, the absolute being. God is eternal, and he desires that his object partner, whom he loves, should live eternally. That is why human beings want to live forever. For this reason also, the absolute God never chooses to see for his children. Each human being had the value of eternity. If God only liked humans for 1 or 2 days, or live for 100 years, and then discarded them, it would not be true love. The more you love, the more you want to be with your beloved one. For this reason, you sometimes find a man whose wife died young, who never remarried, preferring to live alone until his death, while treasuring some article of his wife's clothing. That is why God created human beings, his precious children, to live forever. However, for love to last forever, people should stand on the foundation of action that can generate greater output force. In other words, as time goes by, love power gets stronger, generating more give and take action instead of consuming energy. Hence, the lover joy never ends, but only grows and develops more and more to infinity. Such is the ideal world, the kingdom of heaven in which God dwells. So, powerful quotes for today. If you have difficulties, please watch one more time this video. Share this video as we end this billion happy life subscribers marathon. Contact me for cooperation, consulting, to become a member of this Heavenly Parents Holy Community globally. Subscribe and share. Stay happy, healthy. See you tomorrow, same time, same place. All the best. Bye-bye.